at 5 o'clock. There would be a seminar, and you can be interested also because at the seminar she will discuss another area, which means the same molecular modeling and simulation, not in for gas separation, but what is happening in the field in general of membrane for water treatment, where until now there's not too much attention in using this kind of tools for describing the different kind of phenomena which take place, including also membrane distillation, for example. So there is also this opportunity. For the moment, today, mainly, most of you are interested in gas separation. She will work on the modeling and simulation in gas separation membranes. Thank you. Let me remember, by the way, last point, you have to start to work on the preparation of the exam, as you remember, and as we discussed last time, you are supposed to prepare a report to me, and not too late. That means next week, if possible, for middle of December, I would like to, we have to close everything, okay? Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Professor Drioli. And thank you all. Okay. Okay. So as Professor Drioli introduced, I will give two lectures, how to say, on molecular modeling in membrane science. Today will be a little bit more hard in the sense that it's basic, so a little bit more kind of boring in the sense to more specific, but it's at least necessary to understand the method. And essentially, I will give a background on MD. I will describe also then in which way we can model membranes, and then in 2 days, that is Friday, I will give examples. So essentially is also, I will describe in detail two papers already published, but this is also an opportunity for you, for example, to start also reading this on this matter and try to see and to understand a little bit more about the method. Clearly, modeling is really important, and we have really a lot of kind of modeling, starting from basic, that is also from quantum mechanics, then to go into finite elements. So essentially, and I will describe also later, we can do many things depending on the specific problem, on the specific experiment we would like to reproduce, and specific property we would like to study or to predict. For what concerns my activity, basic phenomena, that is essentially what we can do with molecular dynamics, because at this point we'll study system at atomistic level. Clearly, the necessity of modeling, so to use the simplest, to reduce the experiment to models, is useful because we need to understand fundamental aspects of, for example, membrane science, membrane preparation, also to final application. And also from this understanding, we would like to better go also to simulate processes. And on the other side, the power productive of modeling is quite useful because this avoids us the experimental procedure that is normally trial and error. So I will give all this kind of information, and please, if you do not understand better or if you need details, you can stop me, we can discuss this kind of informal lesson. So please, I'm here also, I will stay here other 3 days, so in case do you have any specific point to discuss or a specific paper you would like to study, I'm here and we can discuss as you wish. So, this is just kind of general information you can find also on Material Studio Auxiliaries, but it's quite specific. Why modeling, structure, processes, property can be simulated numerically. And this is because are based essentially fully or in part on fundamental law of physics. Clearly, there are also another point. Generally, we study stable molecules, membranes, for example, but in some cases there are methods that can help us to understand the behavior of short-lived species, for example, intermediate transition state. This is quite specific of quantum mechanical models, where we study essentially reactions. So we can study all the pathway, going from the reagent to the final product, going on all these states. So it means that essentially we can have really a lot of information depending on the different kind of modeling. The important thing is support or replace experimental studies. In reality, in some cases, we do essentially experimental computational experiment. And in that case, we replace the what happens at the experimental level. But the real key point is also support experimental studies, because when you do an experiment, you have really complex systems. And sometimes the parameter you have to introduce are a lot. And the understanding of all the phenomena requires a lot of time. Or also sometimes the behavior is strange. You can have a tendency going oppositely on what you were principally expecting. So understanding some basic key points is quite useful. It is one of the big roles of the molecular modeling activity. So the motivation is always a more efficient use of research and development resources. And in reality, this is true because if you see, especially from the last 10, 15 years, in any kind of new project is always required a part of modeling to understand or to simulate a process or to understand the basic phenomena. So the importance of modeling and the introduction into together with experimental activity is always increasing. Apart from specific project completely dedicated to simulation that are really reduced, the tendency is always that to combine the experiment with the real the simulating experiment, so the simulation with the experiment, to try to comprehend at both level all things. And this is because, and this is up to now a dream, in the sense trial and error experiments is time consuming, but it's also money consuming, because clearly you have to repeat, you have an idea, a way, and then you try to do this. So the idea to substitute this procedure with a prediction is really useful. Up to now, in some cases possible, in other cases it's not always possible. Depends on the complexity of the system. And then the motivation is a solution to critical research problem, stability, compatibility, and so on. Where we span? As I said before, we have essentially in this slide time that is from femtosecond, 10 to minus 15 seconds, up to years. And this is a dimension of length. 1 angstrom, 1 nanometer, and so on, up to meters. Why we divide and we use on this kind of graph the experiment? Essentially because everything happens in a certain time, and if you go into details, you see that you have that also happens in certain length. For example, you can have here a quantum mechanical, so a reaction. Which are the elements, the key elements of a reaction? Electrons. So the electrons that interact each other, so you can have two simple molecules and then you have maybe a macromolecule or a different molecule. Which is the time of this reaction? Normally it's in the order of femtoseconds. Reactions are really fast. And which is the dimension? Normally depends on the dimension of a length between a bond. So depending on the specific atom that are interacting, we can have that if we have a formation of simple carbon hydrogen, the length could be 1.7, 0.8 angstrom, and so on. So it means that if I have two atoms approaching and then a reaction happening and then another molecule coming, it means that essentially I play in the range of few nanometers, few angstrom, maybe 4, 5, etc. So it means that I can also organize all the events that are happening in nature in time and length. If we go to molecular mechanics, that is essentially molecular modeling, I will explain also later, we work in time that goes from picoseconds, 10 minus 12, also to nanoseconds, depend on the experiments we would like to reproduce, for example. Diffusion of small gases into membranes, rigid membranes, happens in the order of nanoseconds, that is 10 minus 9 seconds. It means that essentially, if we start also less to see from the beginning, and we can go to, we work in this order, so essentially we let the simulation go in this, this time, we can study molecules at some molecular level. The range increases because instead of having few atoms, I start to have a macromolecule, so I go in the range of nanometers. But if I want to study, for example, the morphology of the system, that is, if I have separation of phase, separation of phase into a membrane happens in the order of 100 of nanometers. And also the time for a membrane to blend and to mix and then to have a phase is also longer than few nanoseconds. It takes more time. So it means that we have to change kind of simulation. With molecular dynamics, it's quite difficult to enlarge so much the size because we insert atoms completely. So the amount of calculation is so really huge. Although we also increase the computational power of the computer, then at that point is always this. We have to think always in this way. How much time I need for my simulation in terms of simulating time? 1 year to do an experiment? Too much. So it means that I need to change the kind of simulation to study. I lose something, I gain other. And this happens at every level. So it means that essentially, we can have really a lot of information. So we can also study process simulation, clearly what you do, finite element analysis. But in this case, your simulation goes in the range from minus 2 hours and also the Skylis meter and so on. And for what concerns processes, in reality, you have completely different units. Maybe time is also important, but it's kind of absolute time that is not depending on the, and also the scale is also much large. So it depends essentially what you would like to study. Clearly, it's also important the accuracy. So if we increase the scale of study, going from quantum to mesoscale, mesoscale is in the order of 100 of nanometers and also goes from nanoseconds to milliseconds. What we can study. So, quantum mechanics gives information on reactivity, so reaction, and also some specific features of the atoms, so electronic, optic, magnetic properties of materials, atoms and molecules. Atomistic simulation. So in this point, the starting point is an atom, so that we can have miscibility or compatibility, for example, of membranes, solubility, or also membrane transport, where because it's possible for us to study diffusion, at least of small permeant molecule, and then indirectly we can have also information on flux permeation. Adhesion, that means essential interaction with interface, also polymorphism, crystallization. And if we enlarge the scale, at that point we can study micelles, emulsion, kinetic properties, or also the release profile and so on. Also interesting, sometimes not completely working, CUSARD, that is correlative study on structure and quantitative approach in this sense. Not always working because depend essentially on the database we are able to have on specific simulation data. Now the interesting point is this. When we do an experiment, you make any kind of experiment, you make a membrane, or you measure a transport, or you study other properties, you have something really large, and which is the way you say this is the value of that kind of specific or that parameter. It's essentially you make a lot of average. So you measure several times one diffusion coefficient, sorption, to be sure that in reality the value you have is correct, etc. The point is that we use theoretical methods. One of these is molecular dynamics. And what we have to do is to reproduce and mimic the behavior of molecule and molecular system. Now, the point is this. It's quite difficult to describe a chemical system with a simple description. Because in reality, we work with few number of molecules, and their behavior has to be exactly what you can observe in a large system, in a huge system. So it's also difficult to show this. And also because we use numbers, essentially, in which way we relate this number with, to the physics and the chemistry also of our system. And so the first aid is given by just from the models, how to say, the visualization. This is absolutely independent on any kind of simulation, but really give a lot of help, because at that point, just simply describing in the simplest way, but also interesting way, how is the structure of a molecule, you can soon understand, for example, which is the behavior. So it means that independently on the specific simulation, also the visualization, so the graphic, really helped a lot. And essentially is what you use, because for example, when you start describing a reaction, you use ChemDraw, but also you use three-dimensional model. And this is now a well-known tool for any students also. But this is just visualization. Now how to describe a chemical system in terms of mathematical formulation. The correct description of a chemical system is a mathematical formulation that governs the motion of nuclei and electrons. Now, the point is this. If we study nuclei and electrons, normally we need to use quantum mechanics. So Heisenberg and other in determination principles. And this is a little bit far beyond the scope of atomistic level. So we need, in this case, to simplify our life, in the sense we need to use the classical mechanical law. And it means that we need to describe the motion of nuclei and electrons, but you know, nuclei are that much heavier. So in reality, we think that about atom is nucleus, and then the electron are just moving around. And this has to follow classical mechanics and also has to move in a conservative potential determined by electrons in the Born-Oppenheimer approximation. That means essentially we know that atoms are much heavier than nuclei, much heavier than electrons. So essentially when we describe the law that is the energetic of this system, we essentially describe that of the nuclei, so we can separate the different contribution. They move in a conservative potential, so in a way we can apply also classical mechanics. So in quantum mechanical description, nuclei and electrons are expressed in terms of probability of finding a particle at any point in the space. This is and the electronic distribution as such that there is a probability good, appreciable, of finding some electrons dispersed over an atomic radius because they are much heavier and also highly localized. This is what happens in terms of in deterministic principle. We will jump this point because it's that of reaction, and we say, okay, we can describe this with classical law. Molecular dynamics deterministic is essentially what you have studied in the first year course of physics. And this means that the future state of a system is given completely by the present state. And this means that we can study the evolution of system in function of time, temperature, and pressure. And this is related also to statistical mechanics. So what we do is to treat atoms as they were just objects like car, like any of us moving. So we simplify life, avoiding considering that anyway Born-Oppenheimer approximation has been included. So essentially atom means nuclei. But we don't treat electrons, and we treat all these systems that are chemical systems in a classical way. It means that we can use for the movement of this object that are atoms the second law the force is given by the Newton's second law, that is essentially the force is given by the product of the mass per acceleration, where acceleration is the first derivative of the velocity or the second derivative of the position. Nothing else. It's quite a really simple method. Now, we have two points. One is that in reality, if I'm treating a macromolecular system like, for example, a membrane, in reality, the number of atoms is a little bit large. It means that essentially when I have this derivative in reality and I consider the number of E is quite huge, so and I have a lot of this. And this is quite general, that makes a little bit system more complicated. This means that I can solve this just numerically, but is also a solution for this. You are an engineer, you have a lot of this kind of solution, so it's not a problem. The force depends only on the position or on the atoms, because then we will reduce velocity considering the different algorithm. What is important is the total energy of the system is conserved as usual in physics. And it means, okay, that we have the conservation of the total energy. And coming back to this, now we have to relate the classical object to the chemical object. Because clearly I said I can separate nuclei from electrons, but anyway, these are molecules, so in a way they behave as molecules, so they cannot react. But any kind of behavior that could be associated to property of adhesion or solubility or blending of molecules has to be studied. It means that in a way, what we have to relate is this object, classical object, to the chemistry of the system. And the link is given by this other relation. We said that the force is equal to the product of the mass of acceleration of the object. But we know also that the force is given by the gradient of an energy, in reality of the potential energy. This is quite also first year physics. Now, it means that if the link is just this potential energy, if I can insert in this energy the contribution that are given by a chemical system, at that point I have the chemical system described moving with the simple physical law, and then I can see the evolution of my system. Okay, so in principle, molecular dynamics is really quite simple, the basic. And at that point, if we follow, we can follow the evolution of the system and we can study what happens. But this system is composed by many classical particles. Each particle interacts simultaneously with every other particle and can experience an additional extra potential.
Is
always negative, is the minus derivative of the potential energy of the system. And the limitation, then I will also give the indication about the contribution of, I will describe later. Clearly, we have also some limitation. Time scale, 10 minus 15 is femtosecond. But we can range maximum some second, and sometimes it's also really difficult. The length scale, that means how many molecules I can study. In this, if I want to study the bulk of a system, I need, I have 100,000 of atoms, and this means that maybe all the simulation I have to do is quite long, so I have to use some periodic boundary condition that helps. And then I have to have information on the accuracy of force and classical nuclei. Okay, so let's go to the link. Now let's go to the description of the potential energy. First of all, we said are classical objects. So essentially are kind of soft spheres. Electron cannot enter, cannot be described, but in a way I have to make some, I have to give a more detailed explanation about an atom that is a chlorine, for example, in comparison to hydrogen. So we call soft spheres. Which are the bond between all atoms? Are springs. So the system, this is a 10 molecule, can be described in principle in this way. So coming back, I essentially need to describe better this potential energy. And I have to say that I need to describe it this way, atom moving, linked by spring in this way. Normally, although we have a quite large system, the simplest description is giving this. We can divide the potential energy surface of the molecule into two different contributions. One is all referred to the bonded atoms. That means that if I have two atoms bonded by a link, this is a contribution. But if I have also a third atom, that is kind of the third atom is related to the first with an angle, is always bonded. I can insert a fourth atom. The relation with the first is dihedral. And this means that anyway, these are all bonded. The fifth for me, for us, is not bonded. So essentially, if I have thousands of atoms, I have to separate the contribution of all bonded, so the first two, first three, first four, second to the third, second to the fourth, the fifth, and so on, third, etc., plus all the other contributions. So the first with the fifth, with the 1,000, with the 10,000, is any relation? In principle, yes, then depends, clearly, because if I start, I have a linear chain, the interaction between the first and the tenth is lost in principle. But because essentially we have molecules that are amorphous, so essentially they are just, how to say, maybe you can help me with your English, kind of more crowded in this sense, not linear, but just collected in this way, it means that in principle, like you have the first atom is really nearby the tenth, and far away from the 1,000 and so on. So it means that this contribution is also important. So essentially, we call bonded terms internal degree of freedom. This is, I don't know if you have studied theoretical treatment, the basic of infrared spectroscopy. Essentially, the treatment is the same. We need to divide, so stretching, that is the first two, we call bond stretching. Bending is the movement of the angles. The twisting is the movement between the first and the first interaction of the dihedrals, plus all the other contributions that are van der Waals and Coulombic. Van der Waals, if they are neutral, but they could be a little bit more polar. So in principle, we can entering here all the attractive contribution, repulsive contribution. If I have charged system, I can also simulate the system. So in principle, what I could do, I could insert also a Coulombic law. This is a general description of force field. So let's start from the 2 points, bending. So we said that we relate at that point the potential energy with all this contribution. The first is the bond. And this is quite simple because this is the Hooke law, if you remember. Essentially, this is B0, that is the equilibrium distance and the variation from the equilibrium squared. KB is a constant that is quite important in molecular dynamics because essentially is the force constant that is given from experimental data or also from quantum mechanical calculation. And these data are specific for each specific bond length. So has to be different if I have a single bonded with a carbon, but has to be different if I have carbon with a double bonded carbon or double bonded oxygen, etc. So the general mathematical law is this, but then the chemistry enters really here. And then we could also see the bending energy. Bending means essentially the energy associated to the variation of this angle, that is the constant, and the variation from this. Clearly, as soon as angle enter, we describe the system with harmonic function. So it could be just quite simple. with a constant k that is also defined by the specific angle of intermolecules. Torsion. So the first bonded to the fourth, and normally, because it's this dihedral angle between these two planes, the first plane where the first three atoms pass, and the angle between also the other plane where the second, third, and atom are find. Also in this case, we can have harmonic functions, so it could be cosine, sine, etc. And also this parameter is quite important. In reality, torsion is really important because is important for the correct degree of chain rigidity. This is quite important for in membrane science, in polymer science, because they mimic the steric hindrance of neighboring atoms and side groups. So it means that if it's not correct value, we can have two rigid systems, so it doesn't pack, it's not exactly how we have, it's too much flexible, it's not, for example, the correct description for a glassy system. So what we do normally is also to check this point. If we are making a new force field, if you are modifying the force field because we need to insert other kind of parameter, then we have to check is this energy contribution, and especially if the system is correctly described. Clearly, there are also a lot of cross terms. In principle, I can have a coupling effect between, for example, a bond and angle, two angles, two dihedral, and so on. So all this kind of contribution can enter into the description of my correct system. It means that my system, the energy of the force field start to be a little bit more complicated, but maybe better describing the complexity of the molecules. This is also because we can have out-of-plane interaction and so on. So there are also important parameters, important movement we can describe. And then the really huge part of the work is given by non-bonded terms, because we said after the fourth, the fifth, the interaction is non-bonded, so you understand how many non-bonded interactions I have if I have maybe 1,000 atoms described by my system. And I said before, Coulomb potential or van der Waals. So Coulomb is simple because this is just the Coulomb law. The charge, the effective electric function, and also the distance between them. Van der Waals. Van der Waals is essentially described by these two contributions. One is the attractive part and the other is repulsive. So essentially you have an equilibrium between these two moieties, contribution at a certain distance that depend on, from an atom. So if I have the system too enlarged, this is quite going to zero simply because they are not interacting. But if I approach them too much, the energy goes to infinity simply because they cannot touch each other. And clearly, this is also quite important to give a good description, because we can describe a little bit better the soft spheres, what we said, the classical atoms. And normally, we describe with Lennard-Jones potential 12.6, but we can describe also in some force field with other terms 12.96 and so on. So essentially, you can see this is a general description. Clearly, we can classify and compare different force fields. So essentially, up to now, we said important thing coordinates. Then degree of expansion, okay, because this is what I said up to now. Before is just I gave at the first term. In reality, we can make the system a little bit more complex because we can insert not only each contribution, but also a kind of degree of expansion of the general potential energy function. Then the functional forms, that is exactly which are is cosine appearing in the description of the angle, sine, or what else. Data for parametrization, that is all the k that we were inserting in each energy contribution. Atom type. Atom type is also important because we have to be able to describe in a different way a carbon that is has an hybridization sp3 that has to be different from that sp2 or sp, or different oxygen, one bonded with a double bond to a carbon, or an oxygen in ester moiety or in amide moiety, and so on. And this means that essentially higher is the number of atom type, more detailed is the description of the, more detailed is the force field, better is the description of a specific chemical system. Clearly, the goal, you understand that I have so many parameters entering. Parameter doesn't mean just this, it's just I have really a lot of information to insert at that point. So I can describe with the force field everything, it depends. It means that I have really have a lot of huge force field. In general, what happens? A group of people working maybe on biological molecules, for example, fix the parameter from amino acid. So GROMAX and GROMOS essentially is the algorithm, molecular dynamic algorithm developed in the Netherlands, I don't remember now exactly the group, they were essentially working on biomolecules. So we defined these for all amino acid and DNA or RNA system. In reality, you can find also other force field. For example, the force field associated to polymeric structure is well known, developed now by Axelleri's group. That is not free. It's just a company, but they were much more devoted to the polymer material. Then you can also find other kind of specific modified force field that could be related much more on the zeolite or other system. This because, anyway, once you define the force field, you have to test that, and then you have to modify all the parameter. So, in a way, it takes a lot of time to reproduce also the information. And this is a kind of functional forms. You can find here, for example, how we can describe bond stretching. So we can find this kind of harmonic, cubic and harmonic term. So essentially you can make your force field as you like, just considering some specific rule for what concerns also bending, or also torsion, or you can describe also in different way non-bonded interaction. For example, here we can find Lennard-Jones 12/6 or Lennard-Jones 9/6, or sometimes it uses 12/10 for some specific hydrogen bonds, and you can use also Morse function and so on. So in reality, it's quite large freedom to choose the numerical part. Clearly, each of these has its specific parameter. And in this way, you can describe as at the best a specific system. So this is the point. In which way also are kept, are collected, so this force constant and the equilibrium value. In general are atomic parameters that you can have from X-ray, NMR, IR, microwave, also other experimental data that you can have. In reality you can observe some important information, but also if you use ab initio calculation, because ab initio is absolutely independent value. You start from the theory, in that case you can have really good value, for example, of the length of some bond in a molecule and so on. And clearly ab initio for small molecules, because we cannot do ab initio. The point to use molecular dynamics is because we cannot do ab initio and DFT calculation for large system. And okay, I said already number of different atom type, and also at least we need a minimum set, for example, of carbon atoms in the following the hybridization, so sp2, sp3 to 1, or more detailed force field than other, are able to specify more than 20 different types of carbon. The same happens for nitrogen, oxygen. The more used atom that you can find in molecules can be differentiated in different way. Okay, clearly the way you change this is also trial and error method, because you insert one value, you check, you let your system evolving in time, you study, for example, how is the molecule dispersed in space or some properties, and you at that point you check if the value you inserted corrected is okay or not, and then you have to try. This is. And now, I think this is quite general application. In reality, I think that I have really a lot of slides. I think if you, but anyway, this is the first part. I think is quite general, because this description can be used for different approach. One is you can minimize your system. It means you can find the equilibrium properties of that system. Essentially, you have object that can be treated with simple minimization algorithm that you already studied in your engineering course. You can let the system evolving in time. It means you can study the dynamic of the system. And really important for some, and clearly you can study and obtain several properties that are associated to specific molecular system. The other point is also conformational analysis. This is also really important because, and this is much more important for what concerns the biochemical approach. Because conformational analysis means essentially also how a structure is into space. And this is not so much important for membranes, because in principle they are amorphous or can be crystalline, but the real importance is less important for us to understand exactly if the minimum length of that and behavior that is in a way or in the other, but if I have a biomolecule that interacts in a specific manner with an enzyme or another moiety, at that point is really important for me, not only to make one simple minimization, but to check on all the minimized system, which is the minimum and also the related minimum. So conformational analysis. Anyway, I will not speak about conformational analysis. I will describe simply energy minimization. I give a little bit more about dynamic with also some other contribution. And maybe if, and then I will stop at a certain point in the lesson, I think, because next time I will give some examples. So for what concerns minimization, I try to be enough fast, because I think it's also a method you have already used. So in this case, the important thing is why is important for us minimization. That is essentially, we are interested anyway in the molecular geometry and also in the properties related. For example, in for what concerns the properties of membranes, especially glassy membrane, is really important to know which is the free volume and also the distribution of the free volume. That is essentially how these molecules are as soon as we assume that they are, in a way, fixed. Not completely, maybe not completely at the minimum, but anyway in one of the minimum of all the position. Because this is strongly related to the properties. We know that Higer is the amount of free volume. Normally, Higer is the diffusion into this material. So it means that in this case, for us, it's also important to have the energy of the system. Clearly, for what concerns some small molecule, it's quite important to know, in terms of conformation, it's quite important if this minimum is the most stable, or if there are also the other stable system. And so this is also quite important for the study of conformation. Now, how it works. I was speaking before about potential energy. In reality, we speak about potential energy surfaces, because any molecule can move into surface of potential energy. That was the simplest level. In reality, we can work on this. So in this case, essentially, we speak of hypersurface. and here indicate how energy can change in function of coordinates. It's a multidimensional function of coordinates, clearly, because each system could be x, y, z, or could be internal degree of freedom. But at that point, if I have this simple molecule that is ethane, I have 18 internal coordinates, or 3, 4, 8, 24 Cartesian coordinates. But if my system starts to be larger, for example, I have this ZNT4 that has 1,330 atoms, you understand that I need to multiply this for 3, so I have an hypersurface of about 40,000 dimensions. So it is really complicated for us to understand exactly this behavior. So sometimes it's not possible to study completely the potential energy surface, and this means that essentially we need to find other solution. And so, okay, this is just we are interested to minima, and clearly we can have we describe always potential energy surface. I think you found simply this way, where you can find minima, maximum, global maximum, and so on. So normally this is quite general indication also for reaction. You can have global minimum, that is the lowest minimum, but you can have also local, a little bit higher, but anyway in a valley. You can have a saddle point, that is between maximum and minimum, and you can have also the maximum. So one could be absolute, the other could be related. So essentially, this is just quite simple description. Now, what I want to say is that we need to find also the way to optimize or minimize. So what we need is an efficient algorithm for minimization, because you have always to consider the hyperspace where we move. So essentially, related to the minimum, these are the following apps. This is quite a general approach. Conformation corresponds to the global minimum or the local minimum, or which variation of the molecular structure appear when we go from one minimum to the other. And also, in case we are also studying a reaction, because this is a general approach, you can find also which is, you would like to know, which is the conformation of the transition state. This is quite general, and clearly the rule is always the same. The potential energy, the derivative is zero, it means that we have a minimum. So it's a stationary point. And if I have that the first derivative is zero and the second one is higher than zero, I have a minima. This is also general, we know already. And saddle point, okay, we can drop because it's much more useful for quantum mechanics. But essentially, what we could do, we have to choose the algorithm that possibly we need few iteration, few evaluation of the potential energy. So essentially, in reality, for us it's not so important because we now are able to use directly algorithms. But the principle was quite difficult at the beginning. If energy can be represented by analytical function, minimum can be found by using standard method. In case we have a complicated system, it's not always possible because we have also that energy can change in this system. And so essentially we need to use numerical methods, and this means that we need to have fast and robust and also reduced memory. This is the general approach. There are essentially two methods we use. One is a method that do not use the derivative of the energy respect to the coordinate. And the second is that use the derivative. And in this case, we have the starting point, and then this is the objective, so it's quite a general approach. And the algorithm we use normally is steepest descent, conjugate gradient of Newton-Raphson. The real problem, apart all this consideration about iteration, memory, and so on, is also the point is how we can go to the minima. This is an important point, because if we start from a position, the only choice we can have is to go in local minima. And if we start from another position, we can go to the other minima, that is the global one. So it means that it is also in reality quite important for the minimization, apart the different algorithm we use, is also the starting position. So this means that this is the reason, because we need to start from different geometries to find us minimize in different way, to find all the local and about them to find the global one. And then clearly convergence criteria, okay, but quite important is choice of starting point. Because technically, for example, if you have a large system, molecular system, and you would like to have also some information from the minima, you could also start from, for example, X-ray structure. You can find always, if you study molecular dynamic papers about enzyme, protein, large protein, etc., they think, we started from X-ray. Why? X-ray in reality is a minimum. Maybe it's not the local minimum, but if you find a molecule into nature at that point, it means that it's stable in that state. Maybe it's not more stable in absolute, but you can start from that position and doing your analysis, or quantum mechanical methods, but this is we can make this kind of minimization also if we start from a more broad large system that could be just a structure that's been minimized by molecular mechanics. The other point is starting from casual structures randomly and make all this minimization spanning as much as possible all possible state into the surface and finding the way, the minima. This is quite general because I think it's also quite complicated to study and is much more important for us in membrane science to study directly the dynamics of the system. Okay, I don't know if I can continue, would like me to stop for 5 minutes or which is the procedure, because essentially it's upon you if you would like up to now to make some question or not, let me know.
What is the meaning of the finding the minimum energy state?
The minimum is quite important in case you would like to know, if you are interested, strictly interested in structure behavior relationship of, for example, specific molecules.
Is that related to mass transport? You know, the why we are doing the modeling is to find a way where the molecular is moving through the membrane.
If we are doing that approach, dynamic approach, we are not interested so much in the minimization. But if we are interested in studying specific interaction between two molecules, one molecule with an enzyme, one molecule or a part of a moiety of an enzyme with the solvent, with the structure, so this is quite important. You have to know exactly which is the real, which is the range of minima a structure can be, and possibly which is the absolute minimum. Because it means that that is the structure where the molecule is normally, so in a solvent, so and this is also the way you can understand also a kind of dynamic behavior. It's a kind of, if my system moves in this way, interacts exactly in this way, I can understand a specific behavior. So not everything is associated to the movement. Something is also associated to the interaction. At that point, you need to know at least which is the range of minima.
For minimization, there's no time factor in minimization. So we're just looking for energy, lowest energy level.
No, time no. The time is essentially, yes, because it's essentially derivative in the position. derivative in position or not using derivative, but anyway, you are just into hypersurface, that is the energy associated to the x, so the position. You are looking for the minima in position. Time is not of interest. In reality, time is the problem of us, is our problem, how much it takes for me to have a good minimum. Sometimes it's quite impossible. We need to use several algorithms. Because maybe just the simplest method, steepest descent, let the system approaching quite fast to a kind of global minimum. But then you cannot go.
So this energy level is at specific temperature and pressure? Suppose your energy level is at minimum?
It is associated to temperature in the sense that if you have your molecule at a certain temperature, you assume that as kind of internal degree of freedom associated to this. For example, at a certain temperature, the a chain, polymer chain, for example, is frozen. If I increase temperature, I can go from glassy to rubbery state. That means essentially that the internal degree of the chain is higher than this. But if so, it means that if I want to find two minima, one directly from a system that is at one temperature, I keep that initial coordinates, I minimize, and I found a minima. Temperature, it worked just in the dynamic, because at that point I have just another position, starting position, that has been obtained because of temperature. But at that point, I have just another starting position. I do my minimization, and I found another minima. So temperature, in reality, is to move into the surface, that is, to find other initial coordinates that are the starting point for the minimization.
Which language do you use for
which
language, like C or Java?
Depends. For example, you can find different kind of. First of all, the software I'm using here is in Perl. But you can, for what concerns minimization, I think you can find directly the. There are also books about this, because minimization technique is used not only by chemists, but also by civil engineers, I think. Also, the principle of minimization is quite general. It's the object that is different. In our case, we are interested in molecules. In other cases, a structure, specific structure. And the way to minimize is also different, because you understand that larger is the system, the analytical function has start to be much more complicated, and so. For what concerns minimization also, I think engineers, especially civil engineers, stability of structure and so, they did also a lot, and they used also other algorithms. So I think normally you can find these in internet or in books, maybe C, or maybe now is also an evolution in the programs. Can I start again? I think I have half an hour. I think I was too slow this time. Normally I'm really quick. But okay, I think it's also giving too much information. The basic part is also a little bit not so useful, because at the end, when you see the explanation, it's much more simple. We have also nice figures, picture, and free volume, and everything. We can stay a little bit more. Anyway, which is the procedure when we start doing a simulation? So, starting configuration. We said before, we can start from just, we calculate, we do by ourselves, we use the software, or in case we have experimental data, we can use one of the starting structure. Then, instead of minimizing, so making the derivative in position, what we need is to let the system moving. So what we do is to let the system evolving in time. So we are interested in the derivative in time, essentially. And it means that anyway we need to choose velocity, and we need to start the simulation. starting a simulation, normally we have several points, equilibration stage. At the beginning, you have a really big variation, for example, temperature on the other parameter. And it's just to let the system evolving. Also, it's important to control temperature. Then we have what we call production phase. After a certain time, when I check, for example, the energy in time is almost constant, I can say, okay, now I can let evolving this system for a certain time to study the properties. For example, if I'm interested in studying transport of small gases in glassy material, I know that I need at least some nanosecond of simulation after the equilibration. And then at that point, I would like to see if the gas moves or not. Maybe I have to make it much more longer and so on. So anyway, I can keep this information from the production phase, means that at that point, I can check my data. Essentially, when I do a molecular dynamic run, which are the number I have? I generate what we call dynamic trajectories that are position and momenta in time, during time. And with this collection of data, I can elaborate the system for looking for the properties. Maybe I can jump the relation between mechanical statistics, because I think is, anyway, the problem that I have a three-dimensional space, that is the Coll space, and I need to relate to this to the trajectory, so to the momenta. In reality, what I want to say is this. If I have a property that is, can be measurable, in molecular dynamics, this is represented by the trajectory of individual molecules. In reality, I just elaborate the trajectory of all individual molecules, and then I can have a property. This property, that is a kind of atomistic property, in reality is related to something that you measure. So, what we do normally, we let the system evolving in time in order to have as long as a trajectory, so collecting as much as possible coordinate and momenta, and we make the average on time. We have a value, and we compare this with the value you give me that is essentially in number. Because for you, for example, it's not so important to let the system evolving in time. It's just I repeated this experiment, and then again and again, I measured the value, and at that point, I make an average of all the value, and I have one number that is plus minus something. The value you give me, if possible, I need to compare with the measured property that is given just by a collection of momenta and position. Clearly, is a kind of relation that is the ergodic principle. I don't want to speak here, but we have to suppose that this exists. So essentially, the average I can have is comparable with the average you have. My is on time, your is in number. And then it means that assuming this temporal average along a trajectory is equal to ensemble average over the phase space. Okay, a little bit complicated, let's go beyond, because it takes also some time. I don't want to increase the complexity. Only I want to say is that essentially in space phase is given, is one point in the space phase correspond at atomistic level, correspond to a point in the space phase of thermodynamic level. It means that when you measure something, you normally have, for example, a constant number of atoms, temperature, pressure, etc. So I need to use that canonical ensemble. So normally what we do is, for example, fix the number of atoms, the volume of our system temperature, but also could be important for us, instead of fixing the volume, fixing the pressure. So in that case, it's like working like you work, for example, or other statistical example, depend on what is the measure, what is the value I would like to have. And clearly, you understand that because the equation of motion are integrated with finite difference, because it's an n-body problem. So I have thousands of atoms, or I describe with three coordinate it atoms, or internal coordinate, that is the energy of all the stretching, bending, torsion plus non-bonded term, the number of terms I need to make the derivative to collect the trajectory is quite huge. So we use essentially standard techniques called integration that are also kind of method. So you can find different algorithms already, Verlet, LeapFrog, Velocity Verlet, BIM algorithm. The important thing is that the algorithm should conserve energy and momenta, has to be efficient computationally, because I am interested in the accuracy, but if I have to spend 1 year to have one data, it's clear that I would also like to have an algorithm that is computationally efficient. And also what we go step by step. So which is the minimum step we use to analyze the system? Normally is 1 femtosecond, for example. Could be also interesting to have longer time step for integration. More than one, but also in that case, the energy and moment has to be conserved. So there are several approach. Anyway, we could use position, velocity, and acceleration can be approximated by ethereal series expansion. So I have the position at a certain time plus delta t, that is equal to the position plus vdt, that is the first derivative dt, the second derivative, that is the acceleration dt squared. But I can also do the same for the velocity. So the velocity at t plus delta t is the velocity at time t plus the first derivative, that is acceleration delta t plus one on bdt, etc. And the same is for the acceleration. Just we start position, velocity, acceleration, expanding in Taylor series, etc. This is the general approach. And the useful algorithm is Verlet, because he used to consider the position at time t plus delta t, and also time t minus delta t. And if you make the summation, if you consider the two series expansion, the first is plus, the second is minus. So if the summation, you have just position and acceleration. And we have no explicitly velocity at that point. So we can also remove this point. This is one method, but you could also use other algorithms. Another point is velocity and temperature, because I was speaking about to describe this point. Why? Because velocity are connected to the kinetic energy. Temperature is connected to the velocity. So essentially for us is also important to consider which is initial temperature, that is essentially which is the initial velocity. This is the reason why when I was speaking, okay, let's describe at the beginning the position, velocity, let's evolve the system, equilibration of that, equilibration plus collecting. Because velocity enter, because we need the information about temperature. Okay, it's always point of Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution. And at that point, what we do with the molecular dynamics? We calculate equilibrium configurational properties, but also transport or general, in this case for membrane, mass square displacement, diffusion coefficient. In reality, the analysis we can make could be not only qualitative, but also quantitative. So we can find spatial correlation. All these terms, some of them I will describe also later. So here, X-ray and neutron scattering, we can also calculate and compare with experimental data. We can find also order parameter comparing with experimental data. We can make special correlation of all these data and momenta, so we can find velocity, autocorrelation function, also angular velocity. We can make indirectly transport properties, because essentially we can calculate diffusion coefficient, mean square displacement. Then I think here I'm giving some example of spatial correlation
for example, is useful because we can relate to the radial distribution function that could be easy to relate with particle scattering. So, first of all, let's check potential energy. What you need here is the energy, the position, and if you see that this deviation is not so large. So in principle, if I reduce my scale, this is almost constant, for example. This is the first check. Which stage is equilibrium stage or not? I just make the graph about the potential energy, that is the total one, and on time, simple. Clearly, I can also measure density. This is quite important when I use NPT, because it's really important criterion for what concerns the stability of a membrane, of a polymeric system, of a bulk system. If I'm simulating a membrane, what I need is that the density of the system I'm simulating has to be as much as possible near to the experimental one. This is a good criteria for me to say what I did is correct, is not a number, okay? So a check is also on density. That depends also clearly on how it works with pressure, because if I fix NVT, the volume is fixed, density is fixed. So this check can be done only if I let the volume moving, so if I fix pressure, for example. Radial distribution function that I think is usable here. Look, we have here one, what is this function? You can find probability in space. And is the probability to find an atom X at a distance R from another atom. So clearly an atom doesn't mean specifically one atom, could be one type of atom. For example, one way to check, because not all the force field include hydrogen bonding terms. But if I have a system also with water, and I would like to see if there are specific hydrogen bonds, I can analyze radial distribution function fixing, for example, defining that one atom is the hydrogen, and the other type of water, and the other type could be a specific atom, an oxygen, or in case of nitrogen, or other specific bonding that could be hydrogen related, and then I check on all the space. What I have is that they start with zero, and then I have a kind of first peak that is the Higgs probability, and normally if I have an hydrogen bonding, this is in the range between 1.2, 1.9, depends also on the distance. So high probability means essentially I have hydrogen bonds. If I make a summation, or to say an integration on all the area, normalized, I can have also the number of coordination of hydrogen bonded, for example, or water molecule, if I'm referring to that. So essentially what I do, I just treat my numbers, that is position and momenta, and then I can have a chemical information. It means that essentially we need to know exactly which are the way I can treat my data. So Mann square displacement is another point. I just make some average between the position of one atom at starting from zero time, calculating this average for every delta t, so time t0, t1, t2, etc. And what I can have, so is a value is squared in time. And this is quite important because give a lot of information about the diffusion of the molecules. Here is is related to, I think, I don't know if I inserted here, anyway, if we calculate the gradient, so if we calculate the dependence of this curve and we divide by 6, essentially, if this is linear in time, we can have diffusion coefficient. So, is another information how to treat my data. Radius of gyration is also important in case to see if a polymer is more or less compact. So this is quite related. So in this case, the root Mann square distance of the atom on a molecule, so I can calculate in time. And this means that essentially I can have this information that could be related, for example, with X-ray data and NMR data. Here is an example we did in our previous paper, the radius of gyration of two molecules. One is hydroxypolyimide and the other one is TRPBO treated. And what we can say that here essentially is quite more This is because we started with different angles. So essentially you can see that here the radius of gyration is a little bit more strict in this case. It means that the essential is more compact than in the other. These are almost fixed. X-ray, you can compare, you can analyze your data in this way, and then you can have scattering intensity. So in this case, you can also compare with the experimental data. Shear viscosity, I jump in this way because I think I have 10 minutes. Clustering, also, this could be useful, for example. Maybe it's not so useful in membrane, but could be also useful to check if I have a group of atoms that has some kind of similarity, and this is useful for analysis. Ah, this is thermodynamic properties are also important. Enthalpy of vaporization. That is, the energy required to overcome the intermolecular interaction in the liquid state. So it's, for example, important to find new parameter for new liquids. In which way we can do? We start from the energy in the gaseous phase, that in liquid phase, plus RT. The difference in the energy calculated in these two states gives us the delta H. Or free energy of solvation. This is done using thermodynamic integration method. For example, if we have water and solute, what we could do? We start for calculating the delta G of water. So I calculate water and solute, then I remove solute and I calculate the energy of water. So the difference in energy of these two systems is essentially the energy of water. The same is solute in vacuum, or the solute remove the solute. So essentially, this delta G is given by these two delta G. So in principle, by simple calculation, we could have this kind of information. Rotman square fluctuation. Also, we can have this information locating region with high, low mobility, or B-factors. Hydrogen bonds, quite important. We already analyzed in different ways. This could be really important for a specific system. Correlation function, time correlation function, that in a way is related also, is another way to calculate diffusion coefficient, especially in this way, autocorrelation function. And these are all general methods that all chemists can use to treat this position and momenta to find the property of interest. For what concerns membrane, we are essentially, one of the field is transport properties. It's not the major, honestly, because transport property is important, clearly, but was especially important at the beginning when it was supposed that the transport in dense system was that predicted by Barrer in the 50s. So we have an activated jump. And if you have a dense system, you cannot cut and see what is inside. You cannot use a microscope. You cannot, in reality, it's not so simple like the other membrane. So how a gas moves through, in reality, it was supposed. And in reality, what happens is that with the first paper around 15 years ago, was quite simple to see the movement of gas and this jump event from one side to another. So at the beginning was really important. Today is also useful to calculate diffusion coefficient, solubility, especially for a complicated system. Permeability is just the product of them. I think today the important parameter is essentially related to the structures or other processes. So what is, and also the example I will show in 2 days, now is kind of literature data. It's useful to understand the behavior. Now it's not so much interesting, apart from some specific membrane. Specific membrane that have a kind of distribution of free volume in such a way that or hourglass shape in such a way that are able to select one gas in comparison to the other. So the interest is not just to seeing specific gas, although in reality the gas studied all this year were especially hydrogen, nitrogen, CO2, methane, but larger alkane have not been studied yet because of the complexity. So anyway, part of this work is literature, new field will be studied, but the interest is especially related not on the gases, but on the membrane material. And anyway, the important thing is this, that the information we can have from diffusion coefficient works on the Einstein relation, which is, so you recognize here RT mean RT zero squared, and the average that is the mean square displacement. So if I have a system and the simulation time long enough, because the time here has to be, sorry, has to be T, not X, infinity, to infinite. So it means that we are in the range of Brownian dynamic. It's a random walk. At that point, we have that the, if we have the gradient, how to say, divided by 6t, in that case, we can have diffusion coefficient. So this means that it's quite useful. And this means also that I need really long dynamics anyway. And other way is also to calculating the autocorrelation function in case of low concentration, that for a long time is equivalent to this. Now, it's important to say one thing. Normally, we use these two structures, these two formulas, when the concentration of gases is really low. So essentially, what we are calculating here and here is auto diffusion in the low limit, so auto diffusion coefficient is not related normally to the diffusion when a lot of molecule interacts. So we are just assuming that we are in the almost zero concentration. Each molecule is interacting, just is moving into a space, is not interacting possibly with the matrix, but anyway, if it's interacting with the matrix, we call that regime anomalous regime. In case it's not more interacting, but it's just jumping, and I can measure all this, essentially I have diffusion, I can calculate diffusion coefficient. So random walk, no memory, and no correlation more. That gives rise to anomalous diffusion. That is essentially the motion that is restricted due to the environment. And the last thing, anyway, about this part, I will give the example Friday, in the sense that I will show you also what does it mean, anomalous diffusion in glassy material and random walk. And now, just to finish the treatment of molecular dynamics, just some practical aspect of computer simulation in this point. If I have 1,000 atoms, this is about 500,000 terms regarding non-bonded interaction. And 10,000 is about 50 million terms. So it means that essentially, if I have a system of 10,000 atoms, the number of interaction is really huge. Now, all these interacting terms are really important for the calculation of the properties. Maybe it's not so important that to insert everything, because maybe at the end the effective influence of interaction is almost zero if they are so far away, they don't feel each other. But if I do the I have all the system, so essentially I calculate the derivative, I have to count. It means that it takes for me some time. So one is the time of calculation, one is the effective value. At that point, the strategy is this. I would like to have the higher accuracy, but on the other side, I would like to speed up the calculation. So I have to find always an average between these two points. It means that for me it could be simple to use a cutoff distance. A cutoff distance is just a distance from an atom or reference in which I say, okay, this atom into this cutoff distance feels the other in a certain way. More than this doesn't feel nothing, so at that point I can at least avoid all this calculation. The other limit is if I increase, I reduce too much the cutoff, at that point I have really low amount of, interaction, of calculation, but I lose the chemistry because maybe at that point I'm losing a lot of information. So cutoff has to be always, also in that case, appropriately checked. Normally, if we have a periodic box, of three-dimensional periodic box of certain length, we include almost the half. So this is this is also an important parameter cutoff. And the other point is periodic boundary condition. Suppose that you have your system with atom moving into your system is defined by this cubic box. What happens if I have I would like to save the energy of my system? It means that if I have this atom moving outside, in a way, because the energy has to be conservative, it means the derivative has to be preserved, also this atom has to enter in this side. So we simplify our life considering periodic boundary conditions. So we use a relatively small number of particles, but in such a way that the particle experience forces on so they were in a bulk solution. So in this way we solve the problem of increasing the number of atoms to correctly define a chemical system. So reduce the number, but we need to be in a condition that they have to be like in a bulk system. Okay? So it means that in principle you can find that your system is quite large. I would like maybe to show you. If I use periodic boundary condition, they enter inside, but in reality they are just images because they spread off. I can use also b-dimensional periodic boundary condition because I'm interested in studying surface. It means that at that point one has to be free. For example, let this system interacting with the water, or there are several applications that are not the bulk, it's just surface. This could be solved by two-dimensional periodic boundary conditions. Another point is how to treat solvent. This is also is general information, but it's also important because clearly we know that could influence structure dynamics, thermodynamics. So we can treat implicitly. We just include a dielectric constant into the simulation, or we insert the molecule. It means that we need to insert in this way the certain number of molecules that if we would like to have, for example, a swollen system, or we are interested to study fuel cell with a lot of water inside, or we're just interested in enzyme, you have to consider this approach is quite useful, especially for biomolecular system, where water play a big role. Okay, mesoscale modeling with JUMP is just this. This is something useful, so at the end, I would like to summarize in this way. I have a problem in the sense I would like to study or to repeat an experiment. Okay, at that point, which is the choice? What I have to choose as a modeling approach? Which is the method I have to choose? What the result? I can understand that. So essentially, when you approach to any kind of simulation, your interest is to know exactly what you would like to reproduce or what you would like to study. It means that essentially you need to know which is the method. I can study a reaction with molecular dynamics? No, for example. So if you want to study something, you have to know exactly which is the method. So What is the choice? And also, the result you have, do you understand the meaning? The other point is clearly, all method is for everything? No, because larger time, larger domain are accessed, specificity and accuracy are lost. So, more accurate is quantum mechanics for some specific interaction. We lose something at molecular level, we lose much more at mesoscale time and size. So, it's also essentially to choose the right method for getting the best result. They have to be analyzed, and this is also a work that modeler have to do. Okay, and essentially I think the last two is other application. You can find apart gases and liquid, vapor pressure, vapor liquid equilibria. Essentially now molecular dynamics is really used by engineers, chemical engineers, not so much by chemists alone. But chemical engineers are using molecular dynamics as an engineering tool because in reality apart the specific description I gave, you can study vapor pressure, vapor liquid equilibria, liquid density, glass transition temperature, polymer properties, diffusion in nanoporous material. So essentially the methodology are different. Algorithms are different, different approach, but all can give this. And Kansamida. Okay.